Welcome to the Sunday Conversation. Thanks for coming, everybody, and thanks for listening. You know, I called the last Sunday talk doing my Father's work because I realized I heard that one of the first things that Jesus said that's recorded is he was talking to his mother, Mary, and his dad, Joseph, and he was like 12 years old. And he said, "Don't you know I'm here to do my Father's business?" And man, that went inside of me like a lightning bolt. I thought to myself, you know, I have a successful business. It's making money. I'm at the pinnacle of my career at the age I'm at and how long I've been doing it. And all of a sudden, my dad comes to me and says, "I need your help." And of course, he was, you know, gosh, 89 years old. And I could tell that he needed my help. And I said, "I'm happy to help," but I think sometimes you can't think about what you're going to do. You can't really, when somebody says that, you can't say, "Well, let me think about it for a couple days." You are either a willing subject or you're not. You're caught up in your head and maybe you, you know, guilt yourself into it. Well, you know, somebody's got to do it. And I don't feel that way at all. I feel like that, first of all, I'm doing my Father's work, Father in heaven, and my father, my dad, who is also my father, I'm doing his business, which are both the Lord's business. And so it's an honor, but it's been a interesting transition from kind of one world of total selfishness, you might say, living the life that I created for myself, to this more life of service, because some of the things that I have to do are thankless. And, you know, I mean, cutting the yards for 10 hours, trying to fix all the lawnmowers. We have like 15 lawnmowers and they were all in disrepair and we were trying. And of course, you know, imagine walking behind a lawnmower for 3 or 4 acres or whatever there was, or 5 acres of different lawns at Tall Timber Ranch. I thought there's no way. So I went out and I bought a brand new lawnmower. And I mowed it with my own lawnmower. And it was fun. And then, of course, by the time the event was over, I got all the lawnmowers fixed now. So I will just take my lawnmower home, and I will be still and mow, as our friend Pat Kelly on our Sunday show. The meditation is be still and know. And he says, I said, "Do you meditate?" He says, "I do a different form of meditation. I mow my field, and it's be still and mow." I thought that was really cute. But I realized that all of us, our lives, have to be representative of the gospel. So when we are out at the farmer's market or the market itself or just the car wash or living your life or doing business, the way that you carry yourself and the way that you live your life and what comes out of your mouth, the jokes that you tell, the way you are. I watch myself on these Sunday talks and I think to myself, I got to stop that. I got to stop being a little kid. And then I go, wait a minute. Isn't that part of the secret, is to be able to still be a little kid? And so I fight with, you know, where do I play and where do I be serious? And I think life is just a honing process of honing who you are and what comes out of your mouth and the type of jokes you do, because I watch my dad. My dad was always funny. He was always telling jokes, always poking people. He had this one thing he did with one of our board of directors. His name's Chuck, and he would call him up Chuck. And just to get him to react and watch his reaction, and that was kind of a game with him and Chuck. And finally, Chuck talked about it on one of the Sunday talks. He says, "He used to call me up Chuck." That's vomit if you don't know what that is. And Chuck says, "You know, when I finally stopped reacting, he stopped calling me that." So he says, even though it was adversity, and I said it earlier before we started the talk, remember a kite rises against the wind rather than with it. Adversity is good. Never fear the winds of adversity, because a kite rises against the winds of adversity. And so my dad was the guy that was the test. He was the teacher that was always putting you to the test. The coach that would ask you to do things that you felt were impossible. He'd raise the bar, say, "Now go jump over that," and knowing that you were going to hit it. And then it was like, "Ouch, that hurt." But he'd say, all right, let's lower it a notch. This time you're going to get over it. And then all of a sudden he was building your confidence, helping you to build your own confidence. I know all of us probably had coaches. A good coach is going to help you to build your own character and confidence. And a bad coach, of course, is the one that calls you a stupid idiot and pushes you to the back and makes you feel like an idiot. I actually had a bad coach and a good coach. So I got to experience both sides of that. My dad almost beat up the bad coach. And it was funny watching this little 5'8" man stand up, and the guy, I think he was about 6'3 or 6'4". And my dad got right in his face, and he basically said, don't you ever try and intimidate my son. He says, I'll tell you about intimidation. And he just stepped closer and he says, you want to know about intimidation? And then this thing happened between them where I saw a giant man basically quivering in his shorts, in his jock strap, because he was a total jock. But there's a saying, he was a man amongst children, but a child amongst men. And my dad stood up to that guy, and because the guy had tried to intimidate me, and I told my dad, and my dad went to that school and stood up to that guy. And that's what we need. We need to have dads and moms that will stand up for what is right because it's right and not even worry about the consequences. Imagine, think about that. Father goes to the school, stands up, and doesn't actually threaten, but does. My dad was a wordsmith, no question about it, knew how to say what he wanted to say without saying the street words, if you know what I'm saying. And but in today's world, you do that and you get in trouble. But there is a way to do it. And my dad would be the guy, he said, I don't care if I'm going to get in trouble, I'm going to do it. You have to be thoughtful with your words. You have to be wise. What is it? Float like a butterfly, but sting like a bee. But we do need... we do need to protect our children, and we do need to protect each other in that same way, because aren't we all inside but little children? And I heard this woman that was, she was a transvestite for like 30 years. She had was a woman that converted to being a man. And I don't know what you call her or him, but her girlfriend said, if you're going to, you know, live with us, because she was now converted to a man, if you're going to live with us, you got to go to church with us. So it's really funny to think, you know, if you just think about that scenario. But that being aside, she went to church with this family that she was going to be moving in with and living with and having a relationship with. And she had an epiphany. God spoke his message into her heart, and everything changed. And she was having this talk with somebody interviewing her about, I think it was called Meeting Christ. And she said, no one was there to protect me. And I thought to myself, isn't that sad that we have children and we bring them up? We spend all the time and the money and the energy that it takes to bring up children and get them there alive, and then we push them out into the world ill-prepared because we're selfish, selfish creatures. We push them out into the world, and then the world consumes them because they're looking for someone to love them. And the world is not going to love them in the right way for the most part. Of course, unless you or I step up and see this person needs to be loved in the right way, which is that we tell them the truth and be honest with them. And many a times I've seen the comments on the social media sites where people say, Roy was the father I never had. And I think to myself, well, you had a father, but fathers don't know how to be fathers. They don't seek the way to be a good father. They don't care about really. They're selfish. They want to play golf or play with their cars or whatever they do, go surfing or whatever the hell it is. And they don't care about their children. And even after they've put their foot firmly on their butt and pushed them out the front door and said, go live your life now, you'll learn, as almost like because that child was a mirror to that parent of their inadequacies, the parent is now going to punish further the child because the parent doesn't want to admit they've made mistakes and they want to blame the mistakes on the kid that's holding the mirror, showing them what they're like. And they're like, get out of my house. You'll learn the hard way. And then the poor kid goes out in the world and there's nobody there to protect them again. So then they start making the mistakes to the 10th power. Drugs, relationships, marriages, bringing children into the world that they're ill-prepared to parent. So it's so sad to me that parents, even though they have these beautiful children, and all little children are beautiful, I mean, even the ones that have flaws in the way that they look. You know, you see these little children on these commercials with the cleft palate, and but if you, for a moment, just look past that little flaw into the eyes and you see the innocent little child and you realize that, you know, you can see through that commercial with a little bit of surgery, they can fix that. And then, of course, we're so fixated on looks that we can't usually see the beautiful innocence of the child. They're throwaways. They're throwaway kids. And isn't that sad?
Yeah, I was just reading Tex Watson. He was one of the disciples of the Manson family. And the way he was so clever and evil, out, there's no doubt. They would do all things together, take LSD together, and he would keep him away from other influences aside from himself. But he never took part in things. He would always have them doing. They never gave it any thought. But the bonding was the thing that he loved them, you know. But they had to do what he wanted in order for him to be accepted.
You're talking about Manson?
Yeah, Charles Manson. He was really a creep. I mean, of the lowest grade. And I think that's what all these followers, they had no strength to stand up to him because they were looking for acceptance and love. And they found it all right, but at the cost, you know, it was just tremendous. Even Tex Watson, he's the one that might have been, but he wanted acceptance. I mean, they told him, how do you murder a woman who's pregnant, you know, and stab her that many times? You know, it's just plain evil. But that's the whole thing. They look, always looking for the answer in the wrong people. That's what happened. They don't know how to discern, and they do, but they want their longing and desire to be loved is so strong it overpowers their good conscience.
Yeah. And you know what? Isn't that because I think from the time we're children, we yearn to be loved by our parents. But when we aren't, we look to the world, right? But as we grow older, we're able to have these little aha moments where we know what we're doing is, God shines a light on it. And we get to look at it and say, well, that's wrong. I know it's wrong, but I don't know what to do. And so we have a moment, and we have all these moments in our lives where God shines a light on something, and we look at it, and we have a little pain of, I'm doing the wrong thing. What should I do? But we will do a drug, smoke a cigarette, eat an Eskimo pie. I know they're called Klondike bars. Whatever it is, you know, have a big meal and indulge ourselves and become gluttonous and sloth. And it's because we don't want to really admit that our life is going the wrong way. And we escape. We don't find the truth and the light from that moment. So how many times in your lives have you had those moments where you look at your life and you go, oh, I know, because God shines a little light on it, just a little bit of light. And you look at it and you deny him and it that you are doing. And for each one of us, it's going to be a little something different along the journey of life. And we deny Christ because he comes for us. He comes for us at our lowest point to offer us his love and his forgiveness. And we go, no thanks, not ready for it. And he waits. That's the interesting thing, and I know I've had to learn this with my kids, because my oldest, who's about 33 years old now, he's got a wife and a baby, a pregnant wife, and I'm watching him now start to grow in a different way. But when he first wanted to get married, he was going about it in a what I would consider an unorthodox way. And I was like, no, not going to happen on my watch. We had a huge tangling of wills. And although it all worked out okay, because all things work together for good for those that love the Lord, it was a tangling. And I look back and I go, ugh, I didn't handle that right. I was way too willful. And I could look back now and see where I wanted to do the right thing, and I was willfully wanting him to do the right thing. And so then, okay, we got past that. He got married, and, you know, everything's great. Now comes the next one. And then comes the next one. And each one brings an opportunity to do things right. And you can either stay in your will and your ego and your pride and your judgment. You can stay on that and go the course that you were taught, or the one that you believe in enough to die for, you know, which again is your own pride and your own will. Because my dad used to say he'd rather be dead than wrong, right? That's another, the other side of that pendulum that swings. But then I have one son that decided he wanted to moved down to Los Angeles. And I said, it's a mistake, but you got to go and do what you're going to do. No matter what I say, I want to tell you what I feel. Here's what I feel. I think, you know, it's probably a mistake. And he's like, well, I got to do it. Got to make my own mistakes. And I thought to myself, this time, you know, three strikes and either I'm out, I better do this right. Even though I know he's going against what I believe, but we all are going to make mistakes. We all are going to have our time, to each in his own time and ability, right? So it's not my timing, it's the Lord's timing. It's not my will, it's the Lord's will. So sometimes you have to step out of the way and say, all right, God, I don't know what to say here. I don't know what to do. I'm going to just tell him what I believe is in my heart, and then it's up to him. He's a man now. He's becoming a man. And so the last couple of years has been interesting to watch, because he continues to live this life. But you know what? It's funny. Without my help at all, he's doing better. Me not pressuring him was the biggest help I could offer. Me not being willful with him was the biggest help I could offer, which was no help at all. In other words, I think my brother Michael said it last week. He said that when Jesus was carrying the cross to be crucified, a woman reached out, or at some point, I guess he was going somewhere, and a woman reached out and touched his robe, and she was healed. And he went back, I guess, and saw her, and he said, were you healed? And she said, when you touched me. And she says, yes, I was. And he says, I did nothing. It was your own faith that did it. So what we have to do as parents, we have to know when to protect our children, and we have to know when to let go and let God. Because there is a period in time when we have to let go of our children. There is a period in time when we have to allow them to fall. And I said to my dad, I've said this before, I was watching my first nephew jump on a trampoline, and it wasn't on the grass, it was on concrete. So if he flopped off, he was going to flop off and crack his skull. And I was running around the trampoline. Every time he'd hop over to one side, I'd run over back and forth. And I thought, this is exhausting. And my dad came out and I said, I can't take it. This is insane. I don't know what to do. He's going to fall off. And he says, well, maybe he has to fall off. Maybe he has to fall. He says, sometimes you have to fall in order to pick yourself up and go, wow, that was bad. I better be more careful. And it's true. We all need to fall so that we can recognize the difference. That's the contrast between kind of heaven and hell. The fallen man reaches out for his Father in heaven and says, help me. And so that's the cry that God is waiting for, is for us to ask. And then in that moment, you are defined. What do you believe? What are you all about? Are you willing to admit your sins and your mistakes and be sorry for them and repent? That's the moment when you're drowning and somebody on the side reaches out and pulls you over to the side and, And it's so simple for God to do that. And you say, oh, thank you for saving my life. He says, Donata, is nothing, right? It's nothing. It's nothing for God to help us. But we have to, we almost have to be, you know, on our death door, you might say. What's next? Next is, do we actually question our own motives, our own character? And actually, are we willing to actually look at our mistakes and not be angry at ourselves for making them? I mean, I look at the mistakes I made with my kids and my oldest. He's the sweetest guy in the world. Absolutely the sweetest guy in the world, because he loves his dad, even though I'm a flawed character. I love my dad even when he made mistakes. We all here have experienced probably mistakes that my dad has made along the path of life, because when you work with him, a bunch of us that worked with him, you know, no man is perfect, and you're going to make mistakes. You're going to forget things. I forgot things. My wife forgets things all the time. She has a horrible memory. I have a perfect memory. I know she makes mistakes. I know she forgets. She's sitting in here looking at me like, what the heck are you talking about? And then she shows me, you're the wrong. I remembered. You forgot. And I have to, all right, I'm sorry. It's harder than hell over the stupidest things, right? It's harder than hell to make a mistake. That damn ego and pride and will and judgment and the dark side, it's because we were living in that dark side. We were living in that pain body, the dark pain body that makes us feel that it's us when it's not. It's not me. That's not me. Me is the little kid that wants to apologize. The little kid that wants to realize he made a mistake. Because little kids, you're like, all right, you got to say sorry. I'm sorry. It's like pretty easy. And you see the pride start to be born when they're 2 or 3 years old. No, I'm not going to say sorry. Not that you have to make your kid apologize, but you got to kind of teach them the difference between right and wrong. But it's so cute when you see that pride being born and they defy you with, I'm not going to apologize. Go ahead, throw me off the roof. They're willing to just take whatever punishment you give them in that moment until you make them sit quietly. The biggest punishment my dad used to give us was make us go to our room and sit quietly with our own conscience. And it was horrible. It was like sometimes he'd give us a chore to do, but it was go to your room. You just sit there and think about what you've done. Oh my gosh. Send me into the flames of my own mind, right?
It's a lot easier to admit when you're wrong too, because living a life, you know, trying to excuse and, you know, the darkness gives you all kinds of excuses for things. And it's such a relief just to, because, you know, if you have a false image of yourself and you may not see, often you don't see it's false, like for me. So it was hard to see the errors because I had an image that was something here that wasn't reality. So when I made a mistake, you know, it wasn't really seen as a mistake. So it was a big relief to see the reality of me in there. And then it's like, I screwed up. Oh, okay. And that's it. That's it. There's nothing. I used to have to punish. I think I had to punish myself. And oh, God, you know, and well, no, it's not. I mean,
we've been talking about that lately. Self-punishment. It's like, yeah. We all do that to ourselves.
I was like, I did it for years.
Decades, I think. I mean, I'm not just you, me, yeah. All of us, decades of our lives live in punishment, self-punishment.
Yeah, but what, it was a lack of faith. You know, it was like, I was kind of in the devil was playing with me, thinking that it was, I had to punch myself as like, almost like a, you know, self-flagellation thing when it's already been done. All that's been done. You know, all we have to do is accept there, and that's it. Boom, it's done. It's like, it's so much easier, you know.
Well, here is a quote from John Wooden, W-O-O-D-E-N, Wooden. Here's a quote from John Wooden. Be more concerned with your character than your reputation, because your character is what you really are, while your reputation is merely what others think you are. And so many of us, now in business, that's a whole nother story, because your reputation kind of is your business. But when you're talking about a man or a woman, a human being, that is the facade that we put onto the world. I am a holier than thou person, or I'm a pure person. You see this a lot of times in the teleministries, or we've watched that happen where these people are preaching up a storm, and then they're caught with hookers or whatever. It's like, you know, it's a false, I guess, reputation, right? A false reality. Because what they really are, I think I said the other day, when you store up your treasures in your heart, a good man stores good treasures, an evil man stores evil treasures, and what comes out of his mouth is what he's truly made of in his heart, right? So how he lives every day, not on television, because that's easy. You can have a whole thing scripted out and all these little touch points and reminders to get you to say your nice speech, but how you live your life day to day is what the true character of the man, that's when it's revealed to those around him. And I, you know, have to watch everything I think, because I have to question, you know, who's really thinking that? Are those thoughts mine? Where did that thought come from? No, they're not me. So I've learned to look at all these thoughts, because I have children, grandchildren, my children's friends, my family members, and most importantly, the person close to me, my wife, who watches the man I really am when I'm not sitting right here talking on this microphone. Who is the real person? What is the character of that real person? And last week's Sunday talk, there was a guy there named Mike. I can't remember his last name. And he brought his wife. And Jan got up, actually, my wife, and she said that was a beautiful thing that he said to his wife. And he says, I'm going to show you the man that I really am by my actions. Okay? And a husband and wife relationship is a really, really special one, because the husband feels like he's got his prize. His wife is his prize, and she's going to have to kind of bow to his pleasure, if I can say it that way. But as the relationship goes on, I think it goes the other way. The wife, you know, takes over the reins at some point, because she knows the real character of that man, and she starts to ride him around like her, you know, prize horse, because she is in control of the big beast, right? Because the horse is much bigger than the man, but the man has the reins, right? In the same way. So the man is so guilty for what he has done and what is going on inside of his head that he has no control over, that he's hoping that his wife will steer him in the right direction. And that's kind of a sad state of affairs. And our friend that was there, he said, you know, that she had made him a better man, but in a different way, because she brought him to himself. And he fell to his knees and he says, you know what? Enough of all this pleasure seeking, enough of all this indulging in everything. I'm going to abstain now and show you what kind of a man I am. And I thought it was very sweet. And there may be more to that that I could say, but I don't want to get stuck on that, because the reality is that in a long marriage, as you go through your life, like I've gone through with my wife and many have with their spouse, you get to experience everything about life, about yourself, about relationships, about anger, hate, judgment, resentment, will, fear, anxiety, hate, love. Notice how I waited that long to say love, because all those other things come before love, because you don't really know what the hell love is, what the heaven love should be. You think all those other things, you know, are kind of the ingredients to the love potion number 9. And they aren't. That's the ingredients to hell. And so when you finally go through all these, you know, what are they going to call that? That's the, as you travel through the valley of death, I shall fear no evil. That's the valley of death. And you get to the other side and you've made it and you go, I know what love is finally. I'm beginning to know what love is. And love is none of what I thought it was. 0% of what I thought it was. And then you start to unlearn all the old, and God puts his wisdom in your heart. And then you start to understand what true love is all about.
I used to be a real people pleaser, and I talked to your dad a number of years, well, it was quite a ways back, and he told me, you know, be patient and stand up for what you see is right. And I screwed that up, I'm sure, a lot, you know, but I'm really realizing a lot of that, just standing up for God, just standing up for what you see is right. That brings love to us. So all my years of being people-centered, it switches. So when you stand up for what's right, then, you know, a mysterious love comes to you and you no longer need people's approval. You don't need their, and your dad spoke a lot about that, you know, about not wanting, and Jesus did too, you know, not wanting the love of the world is an enmity with God. But it's so simple, just that little standing on little things, and then you get fulfilled. So it doesn't matter anymore, you know, the love of people. It just doesn't.
I saw this and it made me think of my wife. Be like a flower that gives fragrance even to the hand that crushes it. That's her side of that 40 years of marriage and relationship, is she has been steadfast in her beliefs. And I had to be the hand that crushed her many times. And I would walk away with her fragrance, that she didn't hate me for it. Not every time, but she loved me enough to take the crushing. And that love inside of her showed me that I was the beast in that moment. And I didn't want to be that beast. So it's a process in life. I'm learning how to love properly at 60 years old.
I think it all comes back to the separation on the inside between us and our dark side. And it doesn't matter whether it's becomes crystal clear in marriage, because the other person's always trying to point out what's wrong within you. And if you relate with what's wrong within you, then you feel condemned by them. And that's when you become a slave to the other person. But it's not just in marriage, it's in everyday life. Whoever you're up against, they're always going to point out the worst thing on the inside. But if you don't relate with the wrong thing on the inside, if that's not you, and if the strength is where you're coming from, the right way, then you handle things properly. It's like, I understand that. I'm sorry about that thing, but here's what's right. It's not me. It's not you. It's just what's right. And you can overcome.
It's not who's right. It's what's right.
It's what's right.
And you can overcome any scenario. And in that process, you become more separated on the inside from the dark side.
The more the pride groweth, the harder it is to admit you're wrong. You'd rather be dead than wrong, right? And we know, you see it. You see it, you've seen it. If you've watched my dad do an exorcism, therein lies the ugly pride that people know is their dark side. The pride wants to be God, the other side of you, the darker side. And you see this thing like kind of controlling this person. Now, those are extreme examples, right? But we all have that same twisty little devil inside that twists around. My dad says, you know, you can feel it in your solar plexus, as he says. And you feel that, you know, your stomach tightening up and your even your fists sometimes when somebody sweet, you know, for us men, our wives, who sees that we've done something wrong and then calls us on it, and we're like, oh, she found me out. She's right. We're saying these things in our head. I hate this. So are you hating the truth, or is it hating the truth? So you got to separate from that. Of course it hates the truth. Of course, you know, we talked about the cross. It hates the cross. The representation of a debt, not a debt, but what do you call this? Christ died because he's obedient to his Father to the end, which set the example and said to the devil, I've done it now, and I'm going to ask all the rest of the people to follow me in this way and to deny you what you want, which is to pull us away from the Creator, the Father in heaven, and take our soul. That cross represents that act, okay? And that's why that dark side hates it. That's why that dark side hates the truth when you are called on it as a man. And as a woman, too. As a woman, too. It doesn't matter. But as a man, it's even worse because man is strong. And but the reality is, Fabian here said it, you know, we have to just, it's much easier just to say, you know what? I was wrong. I made a mistake.
It's such a relief, too, you know, that evil, too. Like, I experienced a number of years where I was trying to hide out, you know, try to conserve the little good that I had left, which was not working. But it's best to wake up as soon as you can, because from my experience, it creates a vortex. Evil creates an energy, and it doesn't want to let you go. And it will fight like mad. And the longer you play with it in your head over years and years and excuses, it's harder. But I mean, anything is doable, right? I feel like it was a miracle that I came out of it. I could have went either way, you know, but thank God.
All of us are that way. It's a 50-50 equation, really. Ralph Waldo Emerson, life is a succession of lessons which must be lived to be understood. And there's truth to that, but as you get that understanding, you no longer have to put your hand in the fire to understand it hot and it burns, right? But in the beginning, we've got to fall on our knees and fall down and break our fingers, arms, legs, nose, whatever we're going to. I saw a friend of mine whose son was doing something on a skateboard and he bit right through his tongue.
Oh.
So he videotaped his son getting his tongue sewed up. And then they took him in and did an x-ray on his nose, and his nose was broken. Now, that kid learned a valuable lesson that day. He's not invincible. And sadly, some people die. They die from their thinking they're invincible. And drugs will make you feel invincible. I was talking about morphine the other day. Morphine, you could care less whether you live or die. You're just like, whatever. But that's, I'm sure, you know, what all these other, I've never taken any other drug, so that's a legal drug. And I remember, honestly, I was dying. And I remember thinking, it's all right. I'm not a bad dude. What's up?
If you think morphine is strong, fentanyl?
What is it called?
Fentanyl.
Fentanyl.
Yeah, that's right. And that's what Floyd George was on.
Boy, you got everything backwards. It's George Floyd. That's all right, though. That's funny. That's funny.
Yeah, but I can still think straight.
That is hilarious. You're right, though, right? You said it's 100 times better or 10 times more powerful. Wow. So therein lies the biggest part of our problem. It's like a friend of ours called us the other day, and he's had a little drinking problem, and his future wife-to-be finally just said, no, I've had enough, and you know, you told me if you ever drank again, it's over. And so guess what? It's over. I love you, but I'm not going to continue this way. Good for her. Good for her, because it would continue to escalate otherwise. So then he goes on this kind of quest to find himself. And every now and then he'll pop a Xanax, which is a benzodiazepine, which is, again, synthetic fix. And if he would go on a walkabout to truly find himself and leave all of the crutches and the canes and all of his aids behind, he would probably have a better chance to find the true man he's looking for. But every time we overeat, smoke a cigarette, pop a Xanax, take, you know, listen, when I got my gallbladder out, they gave me a nice little vial of extra pills to take, of which I stashed away thinking, anytime I have a bad day, I could take one of these. That's the little devil inside, right? And so I finally dumped him into the toilet. But I can tell you right now, the human creature is a creature. Unless you rise above that creature that is ultimately what is you're becoming inside, you will find a way, whether it's, for me, Eskimo pies, or whatever it is, you know, food, because there's a lot of people that escape into food, cigarettes, drugs, cigars, adventure, skydiving, right? You don't think you're getting a natural, super adrenaline rush, right? I mean, isn't adrenaline, they give you adrenaline when you're going to have a heart attack or something. They'll inject you with adrenaline to make your body just go bring and come back to life, right? And I could be wrong. The nurses are going, they don't do that. But what, you know what I'm talking about here. It's another drug. We drug ourselves from within. Adventure, I guess we'll call it adventure, the extreme lifestyle. Driving fast. I've experienced it. I drove so fast one time, I did more than 200 miles an hour. And I want to tell you something. The fear and the faith are like right there. And when you abuse faith because you're thinking, well, God's got my back. You know what I mean? That's a mistake. That's using God's name in vain, I think, in that moment. So I've done it. That's like probably the worst drug I've taken is driving fast. And it's a very interesting high. But every high reaches also swings the pendulum to this new low. And then you have to find another high. So it's a dangerous game. And the problem is, Blaise Pascal said it, all of man's problems are because most men or men and women cannot sit in a room by themselves with their own thoughts. And that's the truth. Go to your room. Think about what you've done. That was the worst punishment we had as children. And he wouldn't put us in there together. You go to that room and you go in your sister's room. No talking. Just be quiet. Think about what you've done. Wow. Imagine if, you know, if your wife could say, you go to your room, you're being naughty, you're not going to get away with that. And you'd go, all right, go sit down and think about it. No way, you go turn on a football, basketball game, you get a beer, you go out to your cars, you go whatever, you go and escape into your own crazy world, and it never gets resolved. It just gets shoved down, and then you come home, and you're kind of on the other side of, okay, I got my fix, I don't need you anymore. And then, you know, it's just these relationships go on for decades where you never deal with the problem. Problem is purely lack of love. That's if you just one thing you wanted to just put a pin on it, what's wrong with this relationship? No love, lack of love, lack of understanding of what true love is, lack of truly wanting to know what it takes to fix this problem. No love.
It's so funny. I don't feel anxiety or anything, but my voice is shaking and everything else because it's the dark side. You know, it's very tangible to me, and it's something. Even I'm like sound like I'm going to cry. I don't feel like I want to cry, but it's a weird thing. It's got kind of control there. What the foundation represents to me is sitting still long enough so that you could experience the truth that nobody talks about, and that's the truth that there's two people in there. I mean, but there's, you've got a spirit in there, and we're all, I know where what your friend's going through, and I know what everybody goes through. And when they first start off in that process, they think, I'm alone, and I've got an angel over here and a devil over here, but they're out here, and I'm having to figure out this thing. And they don't realize that something else is working through them, thinking through them, that the devil's in there he's got the controls. And it's not talked about. It's not discussed. And if it is discussed, they think you're crazy, which is where being still and seeing it, experiencing it for yourself. I remember sitting and listening to your dad on the radio, never met him, never anything else, but I had started meditating. I'm just going, oh, this is kind of cool. This is kind of crazy. You know, you start seeing things differently and everything. And then some lady, and I had started having these little twitches and stuff. I'm like, what is all that about? And I'm sitting there listening. She said, yeah, my left side is kind of twitching up. And all of a sudden, my left side starts going crazy. I'm by myself in the middle of nowhere. And I'm like, whoa, that's what you are. Look at that. And everyone's, oh, yeah, it's the dark side. And da, da, da. And I'm like, oh, wow. Okay, that's what's going on. And it's the thing that's in everybody in one form or another. And it's not discussed. It's not everyone, preachers, even the best of them, talk around it and they talk about love and everything, but they don't discuss the plain fact of the matter is you're not in charge. I mean, whether it's in charge or whether the good guy's in charge, you're not in charge.
You know, I this morning I got up early and my wife says, what have you been doing? And I asked her what she was doing up at 3:30 in the morning. She says, I was reading the Bible. And I thought, well, I can't tell her I'm watching videos about cars. So the truth was I wasn't. I was actually noodling on the internet. And it's funny because what used to be sent to me was buxom blondes and all kinds of interesting things that were trying to tempt me away from the light. And what got sent to me today was the last seven things that Jesus said on the cross, which I thought was very interesting. I won't go into that right now because that's probably a great conversation when we have more time. We're too far into this. That should be a show unto itself because it was amazing. But and then when you are interested in something, the algorithms of the internet, even though I think they're mostly evil, when God is wanting to show you something, he'll bring it to you from, as my dad would say, a dicky bird. Now, I'm not sure what a dicky bird is, but that's my dad's saying. But, you know, an ant crawling across your counter will make you think of something, whatever it is. But in this case, I was given all these interesting things this morning, and here's another one to your point. We are here to awaken from our illusion of separateness. Now, think about that for a moment. It's very interesting, separateness from our Creator. But we are together, we are put in this shell together with this other entity. And we are here to awaken to the illusion of separateness, because we are never separate from our Father in heaven. He is within us at all times. But there's an illusion that we don't have him. We have this other thing. We're stuck with this other thing. We're not stuck with it at all. It's because we keep on thinking, the illusion, that, well, it's just me. It ain't me. It's not me. God is within me. We all have this illusion that we're stuck where we are. And we're not. We have to awaken to that. And come to realize that the Father in heaven is within. And the more you do that, the more that thing, Brian, wiggles and shakes and churns and moves and throws things at you and tries to tempt you and tries to torment you. But be still and know that I am God, he says. And that stillness and that calm through the meditation exercise will eventually starve that dark side out. In the battle between good and evil, which one wins? The one you feed. So don't feed the evil side. Don't pay attention to it. Don't have conversations with it. Don't believe nor disbelieve. We talked about this a few weeks ago. My dad said it. I said it a million times. But to hear that I don't have to struggle and fight and argue with this thing inside of my head was freedom to me. It was freedom. I have to step aside and let God do the battle for me. And then there's no battle. If I turn my face to God like the sun, he'll shine onto my face, and guess what? The shadows move to the back. And that's where they need to be. Get behind me, devil, if you know what I'm saying.
All that activity, it's all ego, pride inducing. And when it doesn't get you with your arguing with it, it will like, okay, I'm driving here this morning and I have a realization and I say it to myself in my head, like there's somebody in the car. There it is. It will hijack your insights continually. So I'm seeing the more I see that, let it go, separate from that, then I'm getting more and more free because it uses your own light to try to hijack. And it's very tricky that way. But I mean, that's all part of, so it's like I can't make nothing go on in my head, but the more I see that all that activity is an illusion, the more stupid I am, but not really stupid, but I'm just like, you know, I'm just more free and I'm more like I was like when I was a boy. I'm not thinking about what I'm gonna say. Jesus said, don't think about what you're going to eat and clothe. And he's saying the meditation right there. That is the meditation.
Just live one day at a time. Because listen, if you worry about tomorrow's problems, then you're not dealing with the now. Tomorrow has enough problems, they'll deal with themselves and you'll deal with them tomorrow. But today's problems are today's problems and you just need to be in the moment. Here's another little saying. This one I can quote to this D-O-G-E-N, Dogen, I guess maybe. It says, do not follow the ideas of others, but learn to listen to the voice within yourself. Now, I'll change the voice to the knowing. But I've said this before too. Sometimes I get a knowing. And I know my dad said it's the wordless word. It's a knowing that we are the key to convert the knowing into words because we communicate these words. But a knowing gets put in you. And then, as my mother-in-law used to say, this, I know. And you don't argue with that. But it is the small, still, quiet voice within, which is really the knowing. God puts his wisdom in your heart and you know it. And so as you learn to move towards the light, all of a sudden the shadows are behind you. And instead of living in the shadows, because we tend to live in shadows, we live shades of gray. That's why that movie 50 Shades of Gray was so popular, because it was just sin on top of sin on top of sin, and so many people could identify with it, with their fantasies, their secret fantasies. Peace comes from within. Do not seek it without. That's a Buddha quote. And, about 2 years ago or so, or 3 years ago, God put into my heart this book I'm supposed to write, Conquer From Within. And I went to my dad and I said, I got a name of a book that I'm supposed to write. I said, I don't know what it is yet, though. And it's so funny because I get these little things in my life. And then as I moved through life, I didn't even know what the heck it was. It was a name. So I bought the URL. I think, Brian, you might have helped me buy it. How many years? It's been 3 years, two, 3 years ago. And the more I'm moving towards the light, Jesus, a lamp unto my feet, I'm starting to realize that, it's coming together. And I watch my dad. We all watch my dad with his science. And where did that come from? He told the story. I remember it clearly. And I remember seeing him do this. He was sitting on the diving board of his pool, looking into the water, watching the pump turned on and it moved the water, but he couldn't see any water, but he could see shadows of the movement of the water on the bottom of the pool. Shadows of what? How does nothing make a shadow? It's a good question. And he started thinking about that. And then somebody sent me, or I think in the comments from last week's Sunday conversation or our celebration of life, they said, your father's theory of relativity and time, space, continuum, and wind. And he says, it's all coming true. And they put a link, and I started watching this. And it was from PBS, and it was a guy talking about all the same stuff my dad did. And it was amazing. Now, this guy was probably a scientist, but this all came from something God put in my dad's heart, and he followed that thread. He followed that thread of wonderment.
As far as that book, Conquer From Within, I remember you saying in the last year that God said to you, it's not about a book, Alan. It's about living it. Right. It's about you experiencing it. It really isn't, I'm supposed to write a book. No, you're supposed to conquer from within.
Buddha said, peace comes from within. Do not seek it without. Now, it's interesting because I just let it be. I'm not looking for a topic or a subject, or I'm not looking for chapter one, chapter two, chapter three. It's just coming together. I don't know if you've ever seen how, when they'll do a graphic of something, a cartoon of things that are atoms and they all start forming and swirling around and all of a sudden then they come together, but that is how this is coming together for me. And all of a sudden I feel compelled in this direction to start sitting in front of my computer and waiting for God to help me tickle those little keys. But I feel like, you know, all of us, we have a purpose in our lives. What is that? My dad never stopped writing. He was writing, books on top of books on top of, you know, then it wasn't writing anymore with a pencil on a yellow notepad. Yet we have tons of these notepads. No one could read his writing. It was like, what does that say, Dad? Because he was writing it so fast, the thought was coming along. Then he started, you know, writing it on his keyboard. And then he started Dragon Speak. I remember how many years, oh my gosh, Dragon Speak is when you could speak it into your computer. This is a decade ago or more. And Brian was there. And he would then speak it into life, into words on the pages. And, you know, God bless my dad, had an incredible vocabulary and ability to put these words together. And it was awesome and is awesome. And it's all available for all of us all the time, which is neat. People say, I'm going to miss your dad. I go, really? Well, I didn't ever see you over at his house. Some people have never even met my dad. I'm going to miss your dad. How do you miss somebody you never even met? All his writings are still there. There's thousands and thousands and thousands of hours on FHU.com of his old radio shows. You can't live long enough, unless you're a young, young person, to listen to all those hours. You just can't if you start right now. You can't probably live long enough to read everything he's ever written, because he did it for 60 years plus. So I'm not going to miss my dad. He's going to be with me every day and every hour of every day in some small way. And I hope he is for you guys too, because he is one of those guys that really brought things together in word form for us to have greater understanding about our own selves. How does one man do that?
Roy was brought the Spirit back to Christianity. You know, the church is missing that, unfortunately. But I believe, I could be wrong, but it took, Jesus came from Jewish family, and Roy did too. And I feel like God brought another Jewish man to bring the life, the spiritual.
To help people understand what Christianity is, which most people associate Christianity with, I think, Anglo-Saxon, just the white man, if you know what I'm saying. Does that make sense? Right?
I had a black friend of mine that I work with. We worked together at a school, and he says, you know something, Al? I go, no, what? The white man is the devil. I go, God, Tommy, you really believe that? You know, and he goes, yeah, you know, unfortunately, there's people who think like that. They think that, and you just go, man, what? How do you relate to this guy? How do you reach common ground? I just go, he just went on and on, and I just go, didn't talk to him more about that anymore.
You know, my dad always said, you know, you Christians, he says, I'm just a Jewish boy. He says, Jesus wasn't a Christian. Right? It's Christianity is something that we have kind of conjured up in our minds. You know, we have this projection of what Christianity is. You see the little fish. The little fish is the replacement of the cross, right? Little fish means, I'm one, are you one? You know what I'm talking about with the little fish. Yeah. Does anybody know the meaning of that little fish? What's the story with the fish?
Well, back in the day when Christians were persecuted, that was kind of a secret symbol.
So today's people that are Christians, they want to attract other Christians perhaps with this lure, right? But I think that's a trick. It's a trick that I'm usually pretty leery of, because I know a man's character when I step up to him. I can almost tell within moments, is this somebody that I can have a relationship with? And then you don't have to go very far at all before you find out, because he'll reveal himself, she will reveal herself, whoever it is. So I don't need a lure to attract me over. There is something that is attractive that is of the Spirit. Now that's the kind of attraction I want. I don't want to get people to attract me because I look like, you look at the different religions, that, you know, the yarmulke for the Jews and the different looks that they have for all different religions, right? And it is kind of a lure going through the water to catch others of that type. To me, it's like, okay, I get it. I understand what they're doing. But truthfully, I would rather have somebody be attracted to something about me. There's something about that guy, right? And we know that with my dad. You listen for just a few minutes and you can't see him. It's radio. Something about that guy. I can hear it in him. What is it? What is the it? The spirit. So I don't want to bite on a lure. If I bite on a lure, I'm going to get hooked, right? I don't want to get hooked. I want the freedom that God gives me to know, be still and know. And as long as I am following God's direction, my navigation system put in me by God, then I'm not going to get hooked up with the wrong people and spend a decade or two hooked into this church. I watched my friend. I talked about my friend that spent 10 years here, 10 years here, 10 years here. He finally started his own church outside the walls, he called it. And I feel like, wow, he got stuck in all those churches because he kept biting on the lure, biting on the lure. And you get hooked and you get reeled in. And then, boy, if you can be lucky enough like that one fish that, man, I've caught so many fish before. My dad loved fishing. We used to go fishing. And you'd unhook it and that thing would just start wiggling and shaking. And bam, it's back in the water. You're like, dang it. I want to be that fish that got away because we get hooked every now and then. But, you know, you just got to fight like hell to get away from the wrong thing when you've made a mistake.
The fish symbol is like a worldly symbol, and the spirit is a spiritual symbol. You don't need the fish to identify a Christian. The sheep know the shepherd, and the sheep know the shepherd in someone else.
That's right. That's exactly right. No, somebody, I was listening to this silly thing on the news the other day. I don't even know what it was on. It was on the radio. I got in my car, and this woman is talking about her chickens. And I thought, this is hilarious. She says, you know, chickens aren't as dumb as people think they are. They think they're really dumb. She says, chickens have facial recognition. And I thought to myself, what? And then she keeps going on. The guy says, well, chickens are so dumb you can put them in a corner and they can't get out. She goes, they'll figure it out. She goes, it might take them a minute or two, but they'll figure it out. And I thought, I was listening to this woman give me the rationale about her chickens. And it made me think about my wife with we have this silly little multi-poo, little poodle dog thing that is kind of a creation of man. And it's the funniest little animal you've ever seen. But it loves my wife. It loves her and it watches for her. And when she drives up the driveway, he freaks out. He's barking, running up and down, back and forth. And he is waiting behind that door for his master to come through the door. And somehow he knows it's her. I can drive up. He doesn't do that. He knows he'll listen when she's leaving for the sound of whatever car she may be driving. And he'll lock that away in his memory. And when that sound comes back, almost like sonar, he knows his master has returned. I'm not his master. She is his master. That's her dog, and I know it because he lets me know all the time. But I talk about my friend that I was just talking about, the Christian friend of mine who spent many decades in different churches seeking. He said something about a dog one time, and I've said it on this show, that the dog waits behind the door for the master, and the dog cannot see the master, but he knows the master is there. And when the door opens, the dog rejoices because his master is home. And that is us. When we have faith, when we seek and love the Lord with all our heart, our soul, and our mind, we can't see the master. He's behind the veil, behind the door that we cannot see, but we know he is there. And when he's close, we also know it. And I rejoice now when my master is close. And I feel often that I'm walking with him. And I'm very thankful. I'm like, I know you're right here somewhere. I just can't touch you or feel you. I can feel your presence. And that is where I think my dad lived. He knew that his Savior was with him. My dad was just a different man. He was a different man, but he was on a same path and journey as all of us are on, But the difference is he totally knew and understood and was living in faith. And that's something that we all have to strive more towards, is to live in faith. Not have faith. I have faith. You know, you can say, I have faith. If you have faith, then you live it. Otherwise, it's only an adrenaline fix when you need it. Please, Lord. Please, Lord, I know you're there. I have faith. Help me. It's like that's when you're using it when it's the wrong time.
I've noticed that faith is actually more of a lack of striving. It's actually a realization that you don't have to strive. You relax into his groove. You know, you just gently walk it.
You wondered how Jan got her groove back? Right there.
So I've been watching my thoughts lately, and that's how I'm, just how I am, or doing what I'm doing. And what I noticed is the thoughts that are the strongest have an emotional root to them. It's either rooted in resentment or judgment or pride. And if I just see that, it loses its energy.
Be still and know. If you just watch, it is really truly that you just gave away a very important key. A very important key to the entire struggle is not to struggle, just watch.
Right, because I was talking to Chuck last Sunday, and I was telling him I'm lost in my thoughts, and he said, well, just watch them. And I've been doing that, not 100%, but I find myself, I'm in my thoughts, and then I'm aware of it, and it loses its power.
Its power to pull. It loses its power to pull you in. When you become aware of them, the power goes away, right? And the pull goes away. That's the power, is the pull to pull you down. Because it wants to pull you down in your thoughts. Your thoughts are a downward motion, not a lift. It's a pull down.
I think the interesting thing about what he just said was, because everybody talks about their thoughts, but identifying the emotion underneath it, whether it's resentment, jealousy, anger, to me is really interesting, just looking at that.
It's not that I identify it, it's shown to me. So there's two pieces. There's the seeing and the light that shows it to you.
Right. It was identified for you then, I guess. But seeing that, it's just a neat revelation. That's neat.
Yeah. Here's another quote, Sengcan. So it's Sengcan. Cease to cherish your own opinions. Isn't that interesting? So few words with so much meaning. Now, if you change it just a little bit, cease to cherish your own judgments, right? Because aren't those opinions judgments, right? You're kind of making a judgment, and then you go, yes, you're right. You are correct about what you see about that rotten pig of a man or whatever it might be. That's a judgment. And when you cherish those things, you hold on to them. And if that person changes, you're still holding on to that opinion and that judgment. And just be open-minded. Just live each day one day at a time. Don't carry or cherish your opinions so that when somebody comes up to you, you're not projecting your opinions and judgments onto them as if they were the same person they were a week, a month, a year, 10 years, 100 years ago, whatever it is. It doesn't matter, because if that person changed and you judge them as if they were the person of the past, then you haven't truly, you're not living in the moment, you're not living with love, you're living with judgment, which is the dark side.
I disagree with that term. Judgment is when you're pissed off at them. But you could evaluate a person and get pretty good. And if they continue it, my saying is, a judge is booked by its actions, not by the look, but its actions.
Well, let's dissect this a little further. Cease to cherish your opinions. If you cherish an opinion, then it converts just an opinion, because an opinion can change, right? I can change my opinion. It converts an opinion by the love of the getting the high of that opinion it converts it into something dark, a judgment.
Yeah, but you can not necessarily be angry in a moment and still judge. Because what I saw with me, like, okay, say I'm driving down the road, right? And there's somebody on the side of the road. And I get a thought like, oh, look at that idiot. He's dressed like a jerk. What it's doing is, it's like all thoughts. It's dangling a carrot. And then it's not me. It's, am I going to grab it or not? You know, it can happen at any moment. You'll get just a thought about somebody. And when you recognize judgment is not coming from us, it's coming from hell, you know. So it's just offering us a bite. Are we going to bite it or not?
So you're right. And because I was a surfer when I was young, these things come in little waves. You watch the waves rolling into the beach. They're endless, aren't they? Unless you're on a lake, then the water just laps up on the shore. But in the ocean, these waves come and these continue, the swells come. And so as a surfer, you are sitting there waiting for the right shape, look, feel of the water, the ocean, the swell, the one that will break right and do what you want it to do. And then you catch it and you take it. Your thoughts are the same way. You watch all these thoughts, they come like waves, like swells, never ceasing. If the ocean ever just was perfectly calm, you'd go, uh-oh, something strange going on here. Because there's movement, you know, the tides are going up and down and winds and there's seismic action and all these things are causing these little swells to happen. Now, when we look at our thoughts like swells, here comes one of judgment. Ooh, it's a big one. Shall I ride this wave? And if you do, if you look at the surfer, it takes him on a little journey, sometimes right into the rocks. And so what do you got to learn how to do? It's like there's a saying in the martial arts fighting world, tap out, right? And if the guy taps out, it's like, all right, fight's over. In the surfing world, it's you got to pull out. You got to literally steer off of that wave because it's going to take you into the rocks. And so when you are having these waves of thoughts and you've caught one and all of a sudden you find yourself like you know, you're driving along and you're like, stupid idiot, just somebody walking along. You better hear yourself say that and go, where did that come from? Because it just came out like an uncontrollable burp. It just came out of the dark side of yourself. I've done that. Somebody like pulls in front of me. I go, what an idiot. And I want to flip them off and I want to, I'm riding the wave, right? It'll take you into a hellish place. Things you would never do. Well, nobody's in the car with me. Wouldn't hurt to flip that guy off. He deserves it, right? It's like, that's the wrong direction. You can just say to yourself, well, that was dumb. And then go around him and go on. But if you are going to ride the wave of judgment, resentment, anger, hate, it basically is the devil dipping into a pool of that exists in you. Because if it doesn't exist in you, then it doesn't exist in you, does it? That's our chore in life, is to be able to learn how to not react to any of that. And in the battle between good and evil, which one wins? The one you feed. I want to feed the side of me that leans towards true love the way that Jesus had. Can you imagine Jesus flipping somebody off? Isn't that, it's a funny thought, right? It wasn't in him to do it. It wasn't even in him to do it. He would not call somebody a stupid idiot. He would offer guidance or love or admonish them and say, now, that wasn't very smart, was it? Come here, let's talk about that. It just, the other side wasn't, and if it was, if it tried to hit him, he would look at it and just say, sorry, I'm going this way. I'm going towards the kingdom of heaven, and I'm not taking any baggage with me. So, now here's a guy that flips people off all the time.
Thank you very much. I worked at this place, and my boss who hired me made me the lead man, so we had a new driver come in. He would have me evaluate them. And somehow they found out that he was Jewish. And he was a fair guy. And they were wrong. And one time they were talking about Jewish people. And I says, you know, Jesus never renounced his religion. He says, you know, I'm not a Jew anymore. I'm a Christian. So I don't know if it made him think or not. But people, right away, they say that, but Jesus never said, you know, I'm leaving the Talmud or the Torah behind, you know, and nothing has changed except possibly, you know. People are like that, but it's unfortunate they can't think things through.
Roy actually said recently that, I agree with him, we didn't need a whole nother religion. We really didn't, because he came to fulfill the Jewish faith.
It's an interesting thought. All right, we've gone the distance here, and I'm going to leave you with a Zen proverb, which I think is just really cute. And I'm going to tell you a story real quick that will lead into this as we wrap things up. My daughter one time with us on a boating trip, and she was afraid of the water. She was afraid of what she couldn't see down in the deep water. And she didn't want to go on the little kneeboard thing that all the other boys were having fun. I have three boys and one girl. They were all having fun back and forth and around, up and down, and, you know, pulling them all up and down the lake. And I finally convinced her to give it a try. What's the worst that could happen? Right here, I'll just come around and pick you up, and you'll be by yourself maybe 10 seconds. And so she finally got the courage up to get on the little kneeboard and grab a hold of the rope. And I said, and if something happens, just let go of the rope and I'll swing around and come get you. So she's laying down on the kneeboard and she's holding onto the rope. And I said, you ready? And she says, shakes her head, yes, you know, kind of reluctantly. And I said, are you sure? And she's like, yes. And so I said, all right, here we go. And so I gave it gas. And the rope kind of pulled the front of the little kneeboard down, and it slipped out from under her, and I was pulling her through the water, and all I could see was the water going over her face, and she would not let go of the rope. I'm like, let go. So I let off the gas, but there's a momentum, and she's like, I could see her face through the water, and it was dragging her through the water. I'm like, let go! Let go! But she couldn't hear a thing because the water's going over. And it took about 5 seconds for the boat to kind of come to a stop. And then she's crying and crying. And I went around and got her. She said, I don't ever want to do that again. And so here's the Zen proverb. Let go or be dragged. True story. And that's the same with all of our stuff in our lives. Let go. All right, thanks for coming, everybody.